Hi, this is Mark Brown with Game Maker's Toolkit, a series on video game design. Games with user-generated content can be great stepping stones for wannabe designers. Games like Little Big Planet, simple level-making engines like Duke Nukem 3D's Build, the track editor in Trials, and modding tools for Skyrim let you try your hand at design without having to learn Unity or Xcode or something like that. Which is why I was excited to sit down with Super Mario Maker, the Wii U game where you can build your own Mario stages. I didn't want to build troll levels or goofy gimmick stages. I wanted to see if I could build good levels that follow Nintendo's design philosophies and could feasibly exist inside a Mario game. But when I was faced with a blank screen and a box full of Goombas and pipes and coins, I realized that I didn't even know where to start. Even after thinking back to my video on Super Mario 3D World's 4-step level design, I felt stuck. Luckily, the other advantage to these level editors is that they come with a wealth of content to look at for ideas and best practices, aka the game itself, or in the case of Super Mario Maker, 4 games. Super Mario Bros., Super Mario Bros. 3, Super Mario World, and New Super Mario Bros. U. So, with that in mind, I wanted to analyze a favorite level from each of these games and figure out how they're built, how they challenge and surprise the player, and if there are any ideas I can borrow or steal for my own stages. Let's start with New Super Mario Bros. U and the level Seesaw Bridge, which is in the Soda Jungle. The first thing we see in this level is actually kind of weird. There's a wiggler on these blocks, and it isn't exactly a threat. All you can really do is kill it. An easy win before a slightly tricky level, perhaps? We're then introduced to the stage's main mechanic, these bridges that automatically seesaw up and down. We get a feel for them, but we're in no real danger. The tip never even goes underwater, so Mario is safe wherever he stands, and only has to make a small jump to get on. We get a power-up box, and now a bigger jump between two seesaws. The arc of the coins shows us the optimum time to jump off the bridge. The Koopa Troopa isn't so much a danger here, it's the setup for a fun moment. Mario veterans will want to lob his shell at the other Koopa, and thanks to the layout of the level, this will take out three Wigglers. Before we move on, you might have noticed a not-so-secret pipe. This takes us to an area with the game's optional pickup, a big coin. It's a really hard challenge using mechanics we haven't come across yet, designed specifically for veterans. Anyway, back up top, we see the basic seesaw mechanic has now become more challenging. There's a bigger gap to jump, the platform now dips into the poisonous water, and we see our first interceptor. These are enemies that periodically appear between platforms to make you consider timing as well as jumping and landing. We get another jump with another interceptor, this time with wigglers on the platform, so you'll have to bounce off their backs to proceed. It adds a slight wrinkle to the basic jump. Now the challenge is really starting to ramp up. These bridges have only one pivot point, so they spin in a full 360. Plus, their spins are out of sync, so you can't just wait for them to line up, and we'll have to inevitably do some tricky jumping to stay alive. That block is interesting. Mario games are always asking you to make tricky decisions. You can wimp out and ignore the block, or you can risk everything to get a one-up mushroom. It's optional though, so players get to choose. This section looks quite intimidating, but is actually another setup for a power trip. Mario games, at the end of the day, want you to have fun, and this sort of moment is just there to make you smile. It's really hard to mess up too, as the placement of the Koopa and the Wiggler will make almost every player throw a shell to the right. These red rings cause time-sensitive coins to appear. This is important because playing Mario at a high speed is really fun and exhilarating, but it often makes more sense to play it slow and move slowly. These brief spurts of speed add short moments of speedrunning flair to the game. Imagine how different and how boring this section would be if you waited patiently for each spiky ball to fall before jumping. Next up, a mutation on the spinning bridge. This time it's so long that you can't hope to jump to the other side mid-rotation, but a cheeky ring of coins will encourage some players to make a dumb decision. Part of ramping up the challenge is increasing the distance between safe zones. On this image, the red areas are where Mario can fall in the water, and the green areas are safe. As the level goes on, there are longer and longer periods where Mario has to think fast and react on the spot without being able to relax. So here, you can't even see the next safe spot. You'll just have to go for it and react to whatever the level throws at you. Complete all this and you'll get a reward, an easy 3 Koopa kill. And now the final challenge, a whole bunch of different spinning bridges. There's a mutation we haven't seen before and a long distance until the next safe space. And we finish with an echo to the beginning, a Wiggler that is no threat to us, but we can't help but kill him. There are loads of great moments in Super Mario Bros. 3, but one level really stuck out for me during this playthrough. It was a level that trolled me, that played a joke on me. It's stage 4-6, which is in the game's iconic Giant Land. We actually get a reminder of that new Super Mario Bros. U level here. There's a Koopa who can't actually hurt you, but you'll probably kill it anyway because you're a terrible monster. This is more of a gimmick level than anything. You can switch between the giant enemies and the normal sized enemies by going in these magic doors. It doesn't change much, but it does give the player an interesting choice, and it's a clever idea overall. Now, here's where the joke happens. You bound over this Koopa and end up flying into this wall, which spits out a Starman. If you've never played a Mario game, this thing makes you invincible for a short time and lets you instantly defeat any enemy you touch. Once you get it, you start to kill enemies like this Goomba, and then while you're on your murderous rampage, you decide to kill this Koopa too. But as you try to escape, an invisible block appears over your head, and then another, and then another. The third one spits out a 1-up mushroom, but you probably won't get it, and also your Starman has run out before you get to easily dispatch a pair of Koopa. It's a moment of surprise, it's a joke between the developer and the player, definitely a memorable moment. The rest of the level is pretty typical. Some jumping puzzles and a reminder that while Koopas aren't a particularly tough enemy to dispatch, their predictable patrol pattern can add a slight element of timing to a simple jumping section like this. For Super Mario World, we're checking out Chocolate Island 3. The mechanic in this level is actually a more challenging version of one seen much earlier in the game in Donut Plains 3. This time around, the rotating platform only has one arm. We start, as usual, by getting to experiment with the idea in a largely safe environment. It's easy to get on board, there are no enemies, and there's only one platform between safe zones. Straight away, we see an addition to the challenge. Now, a Koopa is on the central point, which means that if we need to land on that section, we'll have to be careful not to touch the Koopa or bounce off its shell into danger. Now we have three spinning bridges between safe zones, and look at how the distance between these platforms is smaller than the distance between these. It's subtle, but it's still a step up. Again, we can choose to contend with the Koopa and get this block, or ignore him altogether and run along the top. Here, the two spinning platforms are out of sync. Again, a subtle change to how things work, but it adds an extra challenge for Mario to overcome. And like before, we get to choose whether we want to risk going into this pipe. If we do, we're given a really good reward, not just a bunch of coins, but a fun and cathartic minigame in which to collect them. Mario levels are all about balancing moments of threat and moments of pure fun, and providing satisfying rewards to moments of risk. It's actually more of a risk than you might realise, you'll miss the mid-level checkpoint if you take this route. Anyway, that checkpoint is, quite cheekily, hanging in the air and only accessible if you take this tricky high route and then land on this small platform. After some more jumping, we see a mutation to the challenge. Now, instead of a Koopa, the central platforms are patrolled by Fuzzies, which you can't land on, and they go underneath to force Mario to duck during the low points of these swinging platforms. We also get a classic intercept. And then the big finale. Six platforms between safe zones, some of which are out of sync. There are Fuzzies on almost every central point, and a question mark block and two Koopa coins to encourage risky play, and a Koopa Paratrooper intercept. Finally, a vine and one last echo of the level's mechanic let us end the stage. Finally, Super Mario Bros. These stages are often a little more simple, as Nintendo was finding its feet, and this being the first game, every challenge and enemy would be exciting to players in a way that, say, Piranha Plants just aren't anymore. But there's still plenty to learn, and not just from stage 1-1, which may be the most analysed level in any video game ever. Instead, I want to show you something I love and something I don't in stage 8-2. This level reintroduces us to Lakitu and immediately puts us in danger, as we must dodge him, his Spinies, and a Koopa Paratrooper on a broken staircase. This level just isn't messing around. But this puts us in a position where we can quite safely and easily dispatch Lakitu, an enemy that has terrorized us earlier in the game. It reminds me of when you finally get to take down the helicopter that chases you in Half-Life 2. Now, this is the bit that stuck out to me. You jump on this spring, because why wouldn't you, and it dislodges a 1-up mushroom. But you can't grab it, so you have to run through this next bit, keeping one eye on the shroom up high, and another on the pits and enemies down low. It's another example of pushing the player to become a speedrunner, if only for a few seconds, to give an exhilarating moment of momentum and speed. For this next section, we are beset by bullet bills, but if you're an adept platformer, you can avoid them and all the enemies completely by staying on these upper platforms. Until this guy comes along and scuppers your plans, of course. Now this bit kind of sucks. It's just a huge jump. It will sap your lives and it's not an interesting challenge. There's only so far you can keep expanding the distance of your jumps before they become unfair and unfun. After that we get some tricky sections but with very simple obstacles, just enemies we've seen before but in layouts that force you to make precision jumps. We get a final echo of that first staircase but now with even more pitfalls before we finish the stage. So, while I start work on my first Mario Maker stage, let's recap what we found out. A typical Mario level will only have one or two ideas and then iterate upon them to make it increasingly challenging. That might involve bumping up the gap between jumps or making the timing harder to follow. That might mean increasing the distance between safe zones or placing enemies either as interceptors between jumps or as obstacles on the path. It could involve changing the mechanic completely to make it more complex or take away safety nets. We can use coins to lure the player through the level and optional rewards to encourage risky play. We can use time-sensitive events to make a player want to go fast, if only for a moment, and we can offer moments of fun and catharsis, either as a reward or as a palate cleanser between moments of challenge. And here's what I've got. Now, perhaps the biggest limitation of Mario Maker is that you can't exactly make your own level gimmick. You're limited to what's available in the toolbox. So platforms on tracks aren't exactly new, but I'm going to try and find some fresh ways of iterating on that basic premise. At the start of the level, we get to see how these things work and play with it in a safe area. If we fall, a safety net lets us get up and try again. We then get a mushroom and a hint of what's to come. Our first iteration is having to jump between two platforms while dealing with an intercepting Koopa Paratrooper. Then there's this bit where a Goomba bounces off a music block, which to be honest is a bit rubbish, but it happened by accident and I liked it enough to keep it in. Next, there are three moving platforms, and here you get a choice. Are you going to take the easy route and keep moving, or are you going to take the risky option up through these spikes? If you do, you'll have a small gauntlet to face. Bullet bills, dropping donut platforms and spikes. Then a 1-up mushroom chase that I stole wholesale from Super Mario Bros., but with spikes to keep it in tune with the rest of the stage. If you're quick, you'll get the 1-up. If you're not, then it will fall into these spikes. Either way, this door takes you back to the level. I put it in the sky as a little homage to Super Mario Bros. 2 because I felt sorry for it being left out of Mario Maker. Anyway, back down here we have a Koopa on a small platform to deal with. By the way, I chose to use these mushroom platforms because while they act exactly like standard ground, I think they feel less safe. I might be reaching with that one. Next, we have to deal with these flamethrowers. I deliberately put a piece of track going down here so you'd have more time to see how the flamethrowers work. Then you'll have to deal with them. You can escape up here, which puts you out of harm's way, but you'll never know what was in that question mark box. It was a feather. We get a safe zone and, oh my god, I didn't foresee this happening, but I like it and I love how it has a random low chance of happening, so that definitely stays. The next bit sets the scene and is a warning, but it can't actually hurt you unless you jump. But the next version of this, which you can see from this platform, can. You'll get a chance to figure out what to do while you ride up here, then you get a moment of catharsis before the challenge. Now the solution here, of course, is to use the musical note to jump over the blade, but timing this with the platform is a little tricky. I kind of troll you with these unattainable coins, but the real reward is getting to kick this shell down these steps to kill a bunch of spinies and earn a handful of 1-ups. The saw blade in the wall is an echo to the start of the level, kind of like a bookend. And then we get our final choice. Ride the easy platform over to the exit goal, or take this terrifying saw blade ride up here so we can get an extra life. Phew, so there we have it, my first ever Mario Maker level, and I'm pleased with it. It's not perfect, it's a little easy perhaps, the musical note jump could be harder, and the 1-up chase is actually pretty hard to mess up. Bullet bills are slow, it turns out. But in general, I think it's a pretty good first attempt, and it mostly adheres to the principles I discovered in my analysis. So let me know what you think, and when Mario Maker comes out, let me know what you come up with by leaving your level code in the comments below. Plus, please like the episode, subscribe on YouTube, and consider supporting GameMaker's Toolkit on Patreon.